Welcome to Science Class. Today will be our final look at the historical and cultural context of astronomy, at least for a while. After this video, we will start exploring the actual solar system, planet by planet, and then move on to the rest of the universe. But before we do that, we will talk about three more astronomers. These astronomers, well, two of them at least, made unquestionably the most important discoveries in the history of astronomy, and I argue some of the most important discoveries in the history of our species. Galileo and Newton demonstrated, without a shadow of a doubt, the structure and mechanisms behind how objects in the solar system orbit. They truly were the revolutionaries, which I think is our first pun in this entire course. Let's get started. Before we get to Galileo and Newton, we will first talk about Giordano Bruno. Giordano was not a scientist and not an astronomer. He was an ordained minister. I want to tell his story because his story is controversial, and his life ended tragically and unjustly, and the reasons why are important for understanding the historical and cultural impacts of astronomy and how it challenges us. Giordano was a highly radical thinker for his time. He was not an astronomer, like I said, but he still had extremely wild cosmological theories. He was actually right about some of his ideas, but like Aristotle, he had no evidence to support his claims. Giordano believed in the plurality of worlds. According to him, the stars had their own planets and their own living creatures. Now, the first part of that is definitely true. Today, we know that there are more planets than there are stars. The second part, well, we don't know, but I mean, come on, some sort of life has to be out there, you would think. It's hard for us to imagine this today, but just having an opinion like that was dangerous. Today, if you talk about space aliens, you get your own TV show on the History Channel. Back then, though, well, you'll see. He also preached that the creatures of these worlds were just as noble as those of this world. That was a really bad idea to have. Remember, this was still a time where you could count on one hand the number of people in Europe who thought the Earth revolved around the Sun. It was believed that Earth and humans were special, created by God, and the universe and Earth were created for humanity. Giordano also believed that the universe was infinite. That may or may not be true. He also believed that this made the universe endless, limitless, and incapable of comprehension, which is definitely not true. We see that kind of idea throughout history. People either didn't bother studying the world, or they were forbidden to, because it was unthinkable that you even could understand the universe, because it was viewed that the universe was created by a power that we cannot hope to understand either. But this, in fact, was what inspired Giordano's ideas. He was a Christian. The God he believed in was limitless, infinite, and beyond the comprehension of man. And Bruno believed that the universe God created must reflect that. Those are some fascinating ideas, but they definitely were not popular ideas. Giordano was a contemporary of Galileo and Kepler, who were aware of his ideas, but he was not well respected by either man, most likely because he did not formulate any evidence for his claims. But his ideas were also highly incompatible with Christian doctrine. Remember, all the astronomers we're talking about today, and the three astronomers we talked about in the last video, were all devoutly Christian as well. His ideas were so incompatible, in fact, that after bouncing around multiple countries throughout Europe, Bruno was eventually captured by the Inquisition and imprisoned for 6 years to await trial. Giordano was burned to death on 132 counts of blasphemy. All he had to do was say in front of the court that he did not believe the things he said, but he stood by his convictions. This is the part of all of this that is so tragic and unfair, because many of the charges brought against Giordano began with the statement, "holding opinions contrary to death," for having an opinion that challenged conventional thought. Hard to transition from that, but we will now move on to Galileo Galilei. He made so many important contributions, particularly to physics. He's the one who calculated the acceleration of gravity on Earth, 9.8 meters per second squared. He proved that, assuming no air resistance, all objects fall at the same rate. Aristotle said heavier objects fall faster than lighter objects. Galileo disproved that. He's also credited by some as having invented the scientific method. Others say it was Francis Bacon. I said it was Francis Bacon in the introduction to science video. Bacon, who predated Galileo, wrote out the steps of the scientific method as we understand it, but as far as I can work out, Bacon never conducted a single experiment. He also outright rejected heliocentrism. Go figure. Galileo was probably the first person who actually implemented the scientific method. He's probably the first real scientist. Galileo is remembered in astronomy for being the first to use the telescope as a scientific instrument. No, he did not invent the telescope, but he did make his own telescopes and improved their design. Galileo made 5 discoveries, each of which completely dismantled Aristotelian theories of the universe and scriptural interpretations. Real quick, where did the church get the idea that Earth is the center of the universe? There are real historical figures in the Bible, such as Cyrus, Darius, and Nebuchadnezzar, but Aristotle's not one of them, so the original inspiration did not come directly from him. The entire belief seems to stem from a single line in Joshua 10, which says, "The sun stopped in the middle of the sky and delayed going down about a full day." This was interpreted to mean that the sun moves around the earth, because you can't stop something that doesn't move, and nobody thought that Earth rotated. Here are Galileo's 5 discoveries. The first, in my mind, is the most powerful. Galileo discovered 4 moons that orbit Jupiter. Jupiter has many more, but these are the only ones large enough to be seen with ordinary telescopes from Earth. Galileo first thought that they were distant stars, but after observing them for many nights, he noticed that their position shifted, and a new one suddenly appeared from behind Jupiter. He only saw 3 moons at first. For the first time ever, we had incontrovertible proof that something in the universe orbits something that isn't Earth. If you'll remember, Tycho Brahe proposed that the planets orbit the sun, but as they do that, the sun orbits the Earth. Exactly how the moon orbits Earth, but Earth orbits the sun. This, however, was proof. In your face, Tycho! The second discovery was that Venus goes through phases just like the moon. This is caused by Venus's position between the Earth and the sun changing throughout its year. Sometimes most of its lit surface is visible, sometimes only a portion of its lit surface is visible. Those first 2 discoveries established the third discovery, which is that planets were bodies like the Earth. For all of human history, it was thought that planets were stars. The only difference was that they were closer to Earth and moved around the Earth at their own pace. Turns out that, no, planets don't shine, they reflect. Lastly, Galileo used his telescope to learn 2 things about the sun and moon. One was that the moon had mountains, craters, and valleys. It was a naked, rocky world. The other was sunspots on the surface of the sun, and by watching them, Galileo could see that the sun rotated. Now, to be fair, sunspots were known by people before Galileo, but Galileo studied them and published much more well-known work about them. These last 2 discoveries gave a rear-naked chokehold to the Aristotelian theory of eternal and perfect heavenly bodies. The moon was far from perfect. Its surface was damaged, you could say, and the bright sun had dark patches on it. And boy were people angry when they were told the truth. Galileo was well-respected, but he did not become the figure during his lifetime that he deserved to, like Tycho had become. Galileo's discoveries were probably the most revolutionary ones ever, and I really mean ever. You cannot get more extreme than proving for the first time in human history that we aren't the center of the universe. We celebrate Einstein for proving us wrong about what we thought the universe was like, but in the end, Galileo was punished. The unfair truth with science and discovery is that knowledge and information evolves faster than our capacity or willingness to understand and accept it. In a letter to his friend, Johannes Kepler, Galileo wrote that these men closed their eyes to the light of truth. People flat out refused to look through Galileo's telescope to see the proof. He also wrote in this letter that these types of people think the truth is to be sought not through nature, but by comparing texts. Nothing I've ever read so briefly but perfectly captures the distinction between science and, well, whatever else. Galileo published a book in 1632 titled Dialogue Concerning the 2 Chief World Systems, where he argued against Tycho's attempt at reconciling Copernicus and Aristotle. That's what the 2 worlds are, the sun and the earth. The very next year, he was tried and sentenced to house arrest for life for heresy, and his book was placed on the list of prohibited books alongside Copernicus's book De Rev. The Vatican didn't formally accept heliocentrism until 1822. Our final astronomer is Isaac Newton. Astronomer was sort of the least of what he was. Newton may be the smartest person who ever lived. He's certainly one of the most brilliant mathematicians ever. When he was only 24, he published Principia Mathematica, the most important scientific textbook ever. This book laid the foundation for integral calculus, classical mechanics, and helped spark the Industrial Revolution. Principia proved, mathematically, that all objects in the universe have their motion dictated by other objects. This showed how objects fall on Earth, how moons orbit planets, how planets and comets orbit the sun. Principia began as an attempt to derive Kepler's law of planetary ellipses. Newton found that gravity, the force that attracts all objects with mass towards each other, weakens at a certain rate, and not a linear one. The force of gravity is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. What does that mean? Say we have two bodies in space, separated by a distance we'll call d. We can know the masses of these two objects, and we know their separation, so we can figure out the gravitational force of attraction between them. Great, we'll just call that g. If we double the distance between them, the attractive force is not 1/2 g, but instead it is 1/4 g. That's the inverse of the square of 2, 1/4. Triple the distance between them, and the attractive force is 1/9 as strong as it was in the beginning, and so on. That's why everything orbits in ellipses. Newton also laid out the formula for universal gravitation. This makes it possible to calculate exactly what your weight would be on any other world, to know exactly how a projectile will travel through the air when fired at any speed, and so much more. Newton allowed us to not just see how things move, but to know. Now, I'm not a physics teacher, and I don't make these videos to teach you how to work through problems and formulas like you're getting homework. So we're not going to get into all the huge number of ways you can apply Newtonian physics. I just want to end with a few personal touches on Isaac Newton. Newton was the most famous person who wasn't part of a royal family in Europe when he lived, and rightfully so. But Galileo should have been. So why was Newton? He was, after all, so bold and arrogant to assume that he, a mere mortal, could work out the underlying mechanics of a universe claimed to be created by something incomprehensible to him. I'm tempted to say that the Renaissance, the Scientific Revolution, which had sort of already occurred, and the currently developing Enlightenment of Newton's time, grew the collective conscience of Europe. Knowledge was no longer taboo. In fact, knowledge had lifted up the poor and downtrodden, and provided them with the means to make better lives for themselves, and to be seen as equals among all other mankind. Newton has a few brilliant quotes. His most famous one is, "If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants." Newton acknowledged that without the work of Copernicus, Kepler, and Galileo, he would never have discovered what he did. Newton had to have known how he completely changed the course of history and science, and yet he was humble about it. His other quote that I love is from a letter he wrote to a friend, thinking about what I just said. In it, he says, "I do not know what I may appear to the world, but to myself, I seem to have been only like a little boy playing on the seashore and diverting myself in now and then, finding a smoother pebble or a prettier shell than ordinary, whilst the great ocean of truth lay all undiscovered before me." Scientists had been, and continue to be, labeled as heretics, blasphemers, nihilists, and arrogant. Well, it just isn't true. Next time, we will start exploring our solar system, first by taking a grand tour of the general structure of it. Thanks for watching.